Welcome back to Coding Shorts. I'm Sean. Just wanted to remind you that I'm teaching 2 6-week courses, one on ASP.NET Core APIs and the other on Vue.js. You can take a look at a link down in the show notes. When I'm teaching people how to use .NET to build APIs, one of the things that comes up is the idea about caching and cachability. Normally, you might think of this as creating a memory cache or a Redis cache somewhere in your application to store things on the server so you can send them out. But I'm actually talking about the opposite of that, and that is client-side caching, and more specifically, HTTP cache headers. Let's dig in. So here I have our old address API project that I've been using for the last few demos. And I have some APIs, and I have an API here that I've built. I won't go too deep into it, that allows you to get the entries, get an individual entry, and then create a new entry, etc. Now, if we just open up my little HTTP file to test this, let's come down here and run our project. Let's go ahead and get our list of entries just so I can have one that I can work with. So here's 151. That one's perfect. So let's go ahead and look at 151 for an entry. And you've all probably seen this 100 times before. Here's some JSON that represents that object, and in this case, a subobject for addresses. Pretty simple. But in the headers, we have not a lot of information. Content type, content length, what server, when it was done, right? Very, very simple. What we'd like to do is add to these headers in a way that will allow us to think about how the browser might cache these and how your client-side code might cache these. So what we're going to do, let's stop this. And in our console, I'm just going to add a package, Marvin.Cache.Headers. It's an open source project that enables this. And once that's been added, we just need to wire it up on our program.cs or however you're doing your startup code. So first thing I want to do is before I build my app, I'm going to want to say builder services.add HTTP cache headers. There's some options we can put in there, but we're not going to worry about that quite yet. And then after our static files, but before our APIs or other things are mapped, I'm just going to say use HTTP cache headers. So this is just enabling them project-wide. You may want to turn this off and enable it on a per API basis or something like that. And I'll show you how to do that later. But how does this change our project at all? Go ahead and run this again. Let's go back to our HTTP file. Let's go get our entry again. Nothing's really changed except in the headers. We now have a few headers that we want to think about. First is cache control. This is a standard HTTP header that says, how long will this object live? And 60 is not long. That's 1 minute. This is a number based on seconds, and you'll see larger and larger numbers if you think this could be cached for longer and longer. There's now an expiration date, and this is related to the cache control. This is effectively the same time plus 60 seconds, right? And it also shows you when it was last modified. The interesting one here that we're going to be talking a little bit more about is the ETag. Now, an ETag is essentially a version number for this result. While browsers and even some middleware inside of, let's say, Vue and React can use these cache controls to think about when they call, it's much more common for client code to use the ETags to think about cacheability. So I'm going to copy this ETag, quotes included. And what if I go ahead and say, if none match that ETag. With what if none match is saying is, if there is a match for this, don't send me the new object. But if the ETag for this individual object is changed, don't send me that back. And in fact, when we send that request, we're going to get 304 not modified. That's essentially telling it, your ETag matches the version we have inside of the data store, we're not going to return it back to you. You have the most recent case of this. This 304 is what makes calling and checking that cache and seeing if there's a new version much quicker than just repeatedly downloading or parsing that data. You're going to see this a lot, that the browser manages it in very much the same way. We can sort of do the same thing. And if I wanted to modify this entry, let's go ahead and comment that out for a minute so we can get the old result, right? This is our old object. Let's say we wanted to update it in some small way. So I'm going to try to put this, but to ensure that I am updating the most current version, I'm going to actually use this ETag again. And I'm going to say, please update this if match. So if the ETag matches that magic value, then we want to be able to perform this update. If it doesn't match, then we know that we have an older version of this. We also need to put accept here. But what's important is if we just change this a tiny bit to, let's say, 4, it's going to say precondition failed. And that means this if match isn't the same version as what's on the server, right? And so this is a way that I get a 412 back and that I can tell from this put or delete that I don't have the latest version of this object. So if I'm going to actually change it. So what happens if we take this back to 5, which is what it was a minute ago? And let's go ahead and change this to Ella. And let's get rid of that middle name, just as an example. And if we then try to send the request, it allows us to do that because our if match worked. But what if we try to execute it again? We get preconditioned fail. Why? Because this if match is no longer true. And in fact, if we look at the latest version, we can see that we have a brand new ETag that represents the version of that data in that server. And so I would have to change this to the new one. And let's give her that middle name back. And when this succeeded, we can actually look at the headers and see that it's given us a brand new ETag. And so we're going to want to use that ETag in our code when we're doing this to handle that version checking, to make sure you're dealing with the latest version. And this Marvin.Cache.Headers project really allows you to do this in a pretty simple way. Now, in the case of something like a post, this doesn't matter because you're creating a brand new entry. There's no notion, except that when you create this new entry, you're going to get the new ETag for that. You might want to save that in your results so that if you did need to update this later, right? And the same is going to be for delete. So if I say if match delete, because this is the current version, it actually got rid of it. But if the version had actually changed, then this delete would have failed. Because again, delete is saying, can I delete this version? It's the latest version I know about. Is it actually been unchanged? Because you might decide not to delete it. Of course, this is the responsibility of the client. You might want to guarantee that they send these ETags, yes or no. But for the most part, you're going to allow yourself to figure out where you want this to actually be used. Now, in fact, you may decide that this isn't useful for all your sorts of objects, only for some. We come back to program.cs. We can come to this headers, and if we look at the help here, there's actually a bunch of named actions to allow you to specify certain things. And for us, we're going to actually want this middleware options action. So what we're going to do is say middleware options action. And to set that, we're going to use an option that allows us to say disable generation equals true. This might be a little different from some of the situations you've seen because different sorts of options are supported in here. And what they've done is just allow you to call several different lambdas. This lambda is going to allow us to turn it off. Now, if we turn it off to restart it, because this isn't startup and it doesn't know to restart it if we change startup. Of course, we deleted that one. Let's go back here. We look at the headers. All those headers are gone, right? We aren't getting the ETag. We aren't getting the cache information. the expiration date, any of that. But what we can do is decide that, let's say in this entries API, maybe we want to support it for the whole group or even individuals. I'm just going to say add HTTP cache validation or expiration. I'm actually going to use expiration in this case. And I might even want to override like max age and tell it that I want it to live for 10 minutes. In this way, because we turned it off, we can allow ourselves to go ahead and turn it on as we need it. And we'll see if we rerun this, go ahead and send our request again. Look at our headers. We now have a max age of 600 because we made that modification when we added it to our API, and we're supporting the ETag. But if we come down here to, let's change this to 174. Here we're getting that list of addresses, and guess what? No HTTP cache headers, because we've turned them off and we've only turned them on in the API that handles the entries, not the addresses for the entries. Hope that makes sense. Really quick little library can add a ton of functionality to your APIs written in ASP.NET Core. Thanks for joining me. My name is Sean Wildermuth. I'm at sean.wildermuth.com. You can take a look at all the courses that I offer on my website. If you've gotten this far, a like, subscribe, comment, whatever you want to do, it all helps. I appreciate you watching. I'll see you next week.